As Betty's body's brought into church, can I invite you please to stand? May the grace and peace of God our Father, the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, and their Holy Spirit be with us as we gather in prayer this day, reminding us of our shared faith and hope in the resurrection. We will sing together now our opening hymn. It's printed in the order of service. O God, thou. Good morning. You're very welcome to the Requiem Mass for the repose of the soul of Elizabeth Kerr, Betty, to all of us, I think. You're very welcome here in person, her family, friends, neighbours, members of this parish community, of whom she was a part for so many years of her life, and all of us gathered here, those who loved her and were loved by her. And I welcome also those who join us on the live stream, particularly if you are from a distant part of the world and have had to get up early or stay up late in order to be present together with us as we live stream the Requiem Mass. Before we formally begin Mass, I invite you to sit and Jim will come and say a few words of appreciation.
I have known Betty for 50 years, and that has been my privilege, as I am sure it has been for many of you here. She was an exceptional woman. I know that after being with her, you came away uplifted, feeling better, all down to her kindness, her humour, and her support. If you had to choose one word to describe Betty, I believe it would be supportive. As I'm sure the many patients she encountered as an auxiliary would attest to, that quality was down to her deep faith that enriched her life in every way. Her faith meant everything to her and made her a person that had hope in all adversities and love to everyone that she encountered. As St. Paul wrote, "There is faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love." And Betty had that in abundance. Love for her family, her parents, her sisters, her husbands, and her children. her grandchildren and her nieces and nephews. She was a devoted daughter to Richard and Helen, a loving and supportive sister to Mary, Ella, Lena and Catherine, a caring, supporting and loving wife to Billy and Dick, a loving and generous aunt to her many nieces and nephews, but above all, a devoted mother to Paul and Elaine. It was her love, formed by her faith, that drove her, along with Billy, to adopt Elaine and Paul, both unique acts of Christian charity. They did everything for their children, and when Billy died, that support was taken on by Dick too. We can only admire such love and devotion to parenthood, and the result of that are the adults we now see before us. How good that parenting was, we can see in the love that Elaine and Paul have shown in the last months of Betty's life, especially in the efforts to get her home from hospital, despite knowing the work and stress that would bring to them both. While they have been harrowing times for them, they will draw strength now from the knowledge that it would have been Betty's wish to be at home as she met her Maker. Betty has seen tragedy in her life, none more so than the tragic deaths at early ages of Billy and Dick. But in both instances, her faith gave her the strength to carry on, and with the support of Paul and Elaine and her sisters and friends, she found stability again. It would be remiss of me if I did not mention in particular Betty and Peter Tennant, who have always been there for Betty. Betty had a fun side. Her sense of humour was infectious and at times a little devilish, with the sudden comment to take you off guard. She was an ardent shopper. In fact, there are rumours in financial circles that QVC may be in difficulty. However, there are a number of retail outlets that will see less returns. I can remember at Leslie's wedding admiring Betty's hat. The Duffy sisters had a thing about hats at weddings. However, Betty replied, "Yes, it's nice, but I'm taking it back on Monday." We all miss Betty, but when I think of her, I am constantly reminded of the words from the Gospel, "What you do to the least of these, my children, you do to me." I think Paul put it well in a song he wrote, "I was born, but raised by my mother. She chose me. I know I belong there." Betty will always be in our thoughts. She has stored up many graces in heaven. May she rest in peace.
Thank you very much, Jim. Can I invite you please to stand? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The centre of the Catholic funeral liturgy is not a dead person, but the risen Lord Jesus and Betty's sharing in the resurrection, first of all through her baptism. And we will allude to her baptism at a number of points in our celebration of Mass today, particularly at the beginning and then at the end as part of the final commendation. The reason for that is that St. Paul writes to the early church, going into the waters of baptism is like going into the tomb with Christ. So that just as he was raised to new life, we too come from the waters of baptism to live life anew and to know the promise of eternal life. So Betty was called in baptism to new life and to the promise of resurrection. Today, she's called to the Lord's side to know the reality of that resurrection and life eternal. And so we commend her to God, who is always faithful to his promises and always faithful to to his people. My dear brothers and sisters, we believe that the ties of friendship and affection which knit us as one throughout our lives do not unravel in death. Confident then that God always remembers the good we've done and forgives our sins, let us pray, asking God to gather Betty to himself. So as reminders of Betty's baptism, we have a light, the Paschal candle, the Easter candle, the candle we light at the Easter vigil when we celebrate together the Lord's resurrection. It's carried into the darkened church, and all of us take a light from it. It's symbolic of the fact that our faith in the risen Lord Jesus, when we share it, doesn't lessen it, but rather increases the light which it shines. And we give thanks that Betty allowed the light of her faith to shine for others, and that she shared it generously. And we all take a light from that candle, not just at the Easter vigil, but we do so when we baptise someone into the family of God. It's a reminder of who we are, who we're called to be, and how we are to live what we are called to. So I'm also going to remember Betty's baptism by sprinkling her remains with the waters of the baptismal font, praying that God, who promised her life eternal, may welcome her to the home of the saints. Let us pray. Lord God, in our grief we turn to you. Are you not the God of love, always ready to hear us? So listen to our prayers for your servant Betty, whom you've called from this world. Lead him to your kingdom of light and of peace. Count her among the saints in glory. Our prayer we make through Christ our Lord. Amen. At a Requiem Mass, one of the things that we, the living, do is pray for the dead, for the forgiveness of sin. But every time we gather for the celebration of Mass, we recognise our frailty, our fragility, and we recognise that we too have failed. But that is for us not a cause for anxiety, but rather a cause to rejoice in the loving forgiveness of God our Father, for which together we now pray. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart, Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners, Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us, Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. And so we pray. Lord God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we pray for your servant Betty, whom you've called to journey to you. Since she hoped and believed in you, grant that she may be led to our true homeland to delight in everlasting joy. We make our prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Can I invite you to sit and we'll listen together to the Word of God, to the Holy Scriptures.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. We know that he who raised the Lord Jesus to life will raise us with Jesus in our turn and put us by his side, and you with us. You see, all this is for your benefit, so that the more grace is multiplied among people, the more thanksgiving there will be to the glory of God. That is why there is no weakening on our part. And instead, though this outer man of ours may be falling into decay, the inner man is renewed day by day. Yes, the troubles which are soon over, though they weigh little, train us for the carrying of a weight of eternal glory, which is out of all proportion to them. And so we have no eyes for things that are visible, but only for things that are invisible. For visible things last only for a time, and the invisible things are eternal. For we know that when the tent that we live in on earth is folded up, there is a house built by God for us, an everlasting home, not made by human hands in the heavens. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response to the psalm is, "This I know, that the Lord is my help and my light."
The Lord is my help and my light.
The Lord is my light and my help. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Before whom shall I shrink?
The Lord is my help and my light.
There is one thing I ask of the Lord, for this I long: to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to savour the sweetness of the Lord, to behold his temple.
The Lord is my help and my light.
O Lord, hear my voice when I call, have mercy and answer. It is your face, O Lord, that I seek. Hide not your face.
The Lord is my help and my light.
I am sure I shall see the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Hope in him, hold firm and take heart. Hope in the Lord.
The Lord is my help and my light. To hear the words of the Gospel, I invite you please to stand.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. It was about the sixth hour, and with the sun eclipsed, a darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. The veil of the temple was torn right down the middle. And when Jesus had cried out in a loud voice, he said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And with these words, he breathed his last. A member of the council then arrived, an upright, a virtuous man named Joseph. This man went to Pilate, asked for the body of Jesus, which he then took down, wrapped in a shroud, and put in a tomb, which was hewn in stone, in which no one had yet been laid. On the first day of the week, at the first sign of dawn, the women went to the tomb with the spices they had prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb, but on entering, discovered that the body of the Lord Jesus was not there. As they stood there, not knowing what to think, two men in brilliant clothes suddenly appeared at their side. Terrified, the women lowered their eyes, but the two men said to them, Why look among the dead for someone who is alive? He is not here. He is risen. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Can I invite you to sit for a moment, please? Those of us who belong to the family of Christian churches are well used to hearing St. Paul. He's the most prolific writer in the New Testament, and his many letters addressing a variety of topics are still a place where we can find wisdom, instruction, and encouragement. When we do get used to hearing him, we know that he can be both profound and complex, and very direct and straightforward. Sometimes the language he uses is very obvious and very transparent for us. And other times, because we're separated by culture and time, some of the points he makes seem rather obscure and difficult. Today, in that reading we heard, we've got one of each of those. And while some days we may not feel up for puzzling out something that's complex, today, when we celebrate a Requiem Mass, we celebrate a Requiem Mass for someone like Betty. It's an opportunity for us, perhaps, to take a moment to think and to reflect. First, the easy thing. He says that when the tent that we live on earth is folded up, we gain an everlasting dwelling place. A house not made by human hands, a home in the heavens. And we all get that straight away. It's very obvious what he means. We know ourselves that a tent is, by definition, a temporary dwelling, perhaps associated in our heads with an adventurous holiday, or more normally now, unfortunate image of those who are forced to flee their homeland for war or famine. It's somewhere that they don't intend to remain for a long time. It's a temporary dwelling. And we know also the difference between that kind of temporary dwelling and indeed a house and a home. We know the difference. Temporary dwelling, somewhere where we really want to be. And his point, obvious. Let's remember that our time here on earth is as the tent, and our time in the life to come is our home. It's a nice image, and one that's easily accessible for us. The slightly more complex thing that he says can throw us immediately. He says, we have no eyes for the visible. And maybe already we're a little puzzled, what are our eyes for, after all, if not for the visible? We've no eyes for the visible, he says, because visible things last only a time, and invisible things are eternal. What on earth does he mean by that? Well, reflecting on our own situation here, we celebrate Requiem Mass, and then we'll accompany Betty's body to the cemetery for burial, and then you'll return to have a little family time together, and then go to your homes. And you won't have the visible Betty with you. And that's where pain and grief manifest themselves in our lives. Those that we loved are no longer with us in the way that we knew them, loved them, and were loved by them. So he's right about that. Is he right about invisible things being eternal? Well, I'm thinking about what you know and what you remember of Betty. Jim spoke, and her life spoke eloquently of her loyalty, her integrity, her fidelity, her
faith, her love of family, and her caring nature. Those things, those virtues, are invisible of themselves, but visible in their effects, in the way that they touch us and others. And if we take time, as we must, to reflect on what that Holy Scripture invites of us, then we recognise that if we appreciate those virtues in her life and think that that made her the admirable person that she was, then perhaps we're prepared at least to think about the steps that we might take to make those virtues our own, to recognise them, to value them, and to incorporate them into our own lives too. Because they are admirable virtues, but they don't come about by accident. They come about by effort, energy, and an act of the will. So those things which are admirable are presumably worthy of imitation. And I think we do those who go before us marked with a sign of faith great honour by imitating their good example. You know those things of Betty. They made her the loving and lovable person that she was. And they are those virtues of integrity, of fidelity, of loving kindness, of care, of valuing faith and family. They make people strong, and they make families strong when they are understood, lived, and handed on. And if we do that, then St. Paul is right. They become eternal because they're passed on generation to generation. And the understanding that the obligations we have in mutuality and in care are ones which, if we exercise them, build us into the kind of people we want to be and the kind of families we want to live in. They say that one of the last services of the dead to the living is to remind them of the significance of everything they say and do in their desire to be remembered well. In Betty's case, that's easy for us. Perhaps we might understand why it is easy for us. And so when our turn comes, as indeed it will be easy for those that we leave behind to pray, to think, and to value us similarly. And so it is with confidence that we pray for the repose of Betty's soul today. To offer our prayers of intercession, can I invite you please to stand? Each of our prayers ends with the invocation, "Lord, in your mercy," to which I invite you to respond. Hear our prayer. We pray for Betty. In baptism, she was given the pledge of life eternal. May she now be admitted to the company of the saints. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our sister who received the body of Christ, the bread of life, that she may be raised up on the last day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all our deceased relatives and friends, for all who have helped us, encouraged us, supported us and loved us, may they have the reward of their goodness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all of those fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, that they may see God face to face. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the family and friends of Betty, may they be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who himself wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And for all of us assembled here to pray in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, our God, creator and redeemer of all your faithful people, grant to the souls of all your departed servants release from their sins, and hear the prayers we offer for those that we love. Grant them life eternal. Our prayer we make through Christ our Lord. Amen. Can I invite you to sit now? And we will prepare the altar with the gifts of bread and wine that we use for the celebration of Mass. As we do so, I invite you to join in singing the hymn printed in your order of service. Let's stand and pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. We present to you these offerings for the salvation of your servant, Lord, and ask your mercy that she who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may know in him also a merciful judge. Our prayer we make through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ Jesus our Lord. For in him the hope of resurrection has dawned, so that those saddened by the certainty of death might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful people, Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for us in the heavens. And so, with the angels and all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as together with all the saints we acclaim. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna,
blessed is he who comes. Who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
For the Eucharistic prayer, I invite you please to kneel. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, John our Bishop, and all who minister in your church. Remember also our brothers and sisters, fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them to the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, St. Joseph, her spouse, the apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to life eternal, and may praise and glorify you. Remember your servant Betty, whom you've called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your Son in a death like his in baptism, may also be one with him in his resurrection. And may she praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, forever and ever. Amen. Can I invite you now to stand and together we'll pray to God our Father, in the words the Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my own peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, you who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. socially distanced, we offer each other a sign of peace. Peace with you, Bobby. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body and blood, food for our journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Betty may come to the eternal table of Christ's children, he who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Our sister Betty has fallen asleep in Christ. Confident in our hope of life eternal, let us commend her to the loving mercy of God our Father, and let our prayers go with her. She was adopted as God's daughter in baptism and nourished at the table of the Lord. May she now inherit the promise of life eternal and take her place at the table of God's children in heaven. Let's pray also on our own behalf that we who now mourn and are saddened may one day go forth with our sister to meet the Lord of life when he appears in glory. And I'll end Mass as I began it, sprinkling Betty's remains with the waters of the baptismal font, a reminder that she was a sharer in the resurrection, a member of the family of God, the promise of life eternal. And as I do so, I invite you to join in singing our anthem of farewell. The chorus is printed in your order of service.
Receive her soul, and present her to God the Most High. Receive her soul, receive her soul, and present her to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to her aid. Hasten to meet her, angels of the Lord. Receive her soul, and present her to God the Most High. Receive her soul, and present her God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to Abraham's side. Eternal rest give unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. Receive her soul, and present her to God the Most High. Receive her soul, receive her soul, and present her to God the Most High.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Betty in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with them on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings you bestowed upon her in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us, listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant. Help us to remain to comfort one another with the assurances of our faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our sister forever. Our prayer we make through Christ our Lord. Amen. In peace, let us take Betty to her place of rest.
Be afraid, for I have redeemed you. Sing beneath the